Good evening, viewers. Welcome to People and Stories. I'm your host, Jackie Narubama. Tonight, we have a very interesting guest, Lena Pira. She came to Uganda as a missionary, but she branched into publishing. Let's hear how she moved from the pulpit to books.
Hi, Jackie. Thank you so much for having me. It's great to be here.
Thanks for accepting.
Yes.
You talked about doing 50% mission work, 50% publishing. What does mission work entail?
I would say that all my work is mission work.
Yes, you've said.
Yeah,
but
I would say.
But the clear-cut mission work.
For me, missionary work, I think, is different for everyone. The role that I play within my church and things like that always tends to be on writing, and you know, it tends to follow, like, because God has given me gifts in writing and publishing, my missionary service also is in around those areas. So you can find that sometimes God will tell me that, help this person with that book for free. There's pastors that come to me and sometimes my heart tells me, don't judge them. And I'm like, okay, God, I'll do that book for free. I could judge this person, you know, 5, 10, 15, 20 million maybe to do it, but God prevents me. And that's a missionary service to them. And then they use it as a tool to actually minister to their congregations, to minister to other people. So I find a lot of my missions come to that. And it's not just with pastors. I've helped many pastors with books, but it's also with everyday Christians who... You know, people, it's interesting. Some people won't pick up the Bible, no matter how much they need it. You know, like, non-Christian world, when they have a problem, they're not going necessarily to run to pick up a Bible. But people...
Some people look for a self-help book.
Exactly. And so all the Christians that I help write books, in essence, they are all missionaries. Reaching out to others, because if a non-Christian picks up widow's wear lipstick and is ministered and hears God's heart for them and that God loves them even in their loss and turns to God, we have won. So that's where I have a different perspective when it comes to missions. You don't have to be on the pulpit to be a missionary. I love this. You'll probably see, Lena is such an extrovert, she can talk forever. But you put me on a pulpit with a microphone and I'll go blank. Many times I am not necessarily a preacher, but I preach through the written word. You get? So, yeah, so when I help, maybe I've helped churches do weekly summon, you know how you have small groups and you do summon notes and things like that. For many years, about 7 years, I was doing those weekly summon notes for a church so that their small groups could meet. So that's the kind of mission work I do. It's not traditional, but if it is helping God's people either know Him better or come to Him, it's all missions work.
Because some people think going on mission means you pack a bag and go to some far-flung place and then start preaching. We need to broaden up.
Yeah, we do. Like if you're in a church, look and see, what are the needs of the church? Does the church need support in ushering? Does the church need help with setup? Does the church need my help with whatever my specialty is? Like me as a writer, how can I help support maybe the writing team of the church? If I'm good at building, how can I support, you know? Yeah, how can I help support build my church? Like, God won't call you to something that's not who He's ingrained you to be. Yeah, so if God has made you a certain way, there's a space in your local church where you fit. That's why God calls us the body. Like, one person is the finger, maybe the pastor is the elbow, I don't know. Like, the deaconesses can maybe be the chins or the ears. So everyone plays a different part. We can't all be elbows, otherwise we won't function as a body. Yeah, I mean, the elbow won't even have anything that's, what's it going to do? It won't walk anywhere. So I would say when you're looking for purpose and missions and things like that and where to plug in, look at the needs of your church, consider what your giftings and talents are and your character and personality, and find a place. Even cleaning the toilets at churches and missions. Yeah, it is, eh? Yeah. It's a place that is needed, but most people overlook it. But,
you know,
it's very important. Because now if I go to church and I really need to go to the toilet, and the state of the toilet, it distracts me. I'm not going to want to go back there, and I'm going to miss out on the message. So, yeah, we just need to change our perspective of what we consider as missions. Yeah.
Now, back to writing. What is the process that you usually go through when you get a new author as a publisher? What steps do you take a new author through?
Usually when I get a new author, most authors are coming to me with a manuscript already. And so I will ask that author to submit the manuscript to me. I read.
First, wait, are they usually referred to you, or do they just walk around and say, oh, my leap, let me turn?
Most of the people that come to me are referred. We don't tend to advertise all that much. It's kind of word of mouth. But yeah, we are growing. So we are doing work with people in different countries at the moment, 3 different countries. And they were all referred. So sometimes I don't know how word goes. We have someone in Geneva. We have someone in UK, London. We have another person in the US. And then we have about 3 Ugandans in Uganda. And do we have a Kenyan book at the moment? We are working on a possible Kenyan book. So yeah, so we have several. So that's 4 countries. But so usually they'll come and submit what they have. Because there's some that come and say, I want to write a book, but I've not started. Those ones are different. We usually help them develop their concept. But if you already have the manuscript, we look over it, and then we advise what you need to get from rough draft to final. So it will usually come with an estimate and say, okay, you probably need cover design, you need layout, you need this many rounds of editing. You need promotional things, you need print services, you need all these things. We give them the estimate, talk it through, and then we create a timeline and say, to do all this work, it's going to take us maybe 2 months, a year, you know, a year and a half, whatever it is. And then this is our plan going forward. And once they agree to it, we move forward. They usually give a deposit and we start working.
But now this one who comes with the passion, mm-hmm. who has a dream that I want to write,
yes.
but they kind of have no clue.
Yes.
Do they have to pay for consultancy?
No, we don't usually. We don't charge for consultancy at the beginning. We just kind of have usually a short little session, and we say, okay, what are you passionate about? What do you feel you want to write about? And then we'll give guidelines and say, okay, this is what we suggest you do. Start with this, 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 and this. Sometimes we assign homework. There's one lady, she wanted to write a book, so she came with all these great ideas. And we would meet her once a month for about 30 minutes or an hour on Zoom. And then we would tell her, okay, this is your homework assignment. So she would go for the next month, she would do her homework, then she comes back and says, okay, I've done that. Now, what do I do next? So we would do that. Now, at some point, because I think it was free services, she stopped doing her homework and she stopped calling us. So we're like, it's okay. Let her now take her time and space, because you also can't force a book. A reader can know when a book is forced. Yeah, it doesn't.
Yes, it can flow for some chapters, and then it loses the tempo.
Yeah, so you can tell when it's forced. So we usually tell people, if you've come up with that kind of, they call it writer's block, but if you come up with a writer's block, leave it be and wait until it comes back. So we've done that with some books where 6 months we put the book down, we don't touch it at all, and then all of a sudden, finish it in like two weeks, it's done. So yeah, it's an interesting thing. So everyone is different, but if you're also at that beginning stage, you can come and we can give you an outline and a plan on how to get started.
Lena, earlier, before the show started, we were having a chat, and you told me about your childhood, how interesting your father and mother are. I'd like to know, as you also share with our viewers, your family background, How has it impacted you right now? The way they raised you, the way your parents raised you, how has it helped you in your work?
Okay, yeah. So my parents were very interesting. They had a value of hard work, and they trained us as children to be hard workers. So we did things in our childhood that normal children wouldn't do. We built houses. I think I roofed my house when I was 7 years old. I learned how to lay tile. I learned how to paint. I learned how to do plumbing, electrical, all those things. So what they
were teaching... your father.
This is my real father and my real mother. I look just like both of them. And to this day, my dad is a hard worker. He's 70 and he's still working full time. So, I mean, they taught us the value of hard work. But one thing that they taught us, and it has carried over, I think, a lot into my adult living, is that you should never say the words, "I can't." So my mom used to fine us $1 if you said the word, "I can't." Now, what has that done to me? As a child, I used to get so annoyed because I would work hard. I would work in my dad's business. He would pay me a salary of $1 an hour. So you can imagine, the second I say I can't, I've lost an hour of my work time. And he's taken back the dollar. Like, so now what happened was, fast forward, I'm in Uganda and I had started helping people with print books. So I helped people with a print book, and I remember the very first book I helped someone with, right as soon as we printed it and had the launch, the person said, "Now what about ebooks?" So I'm like, okay, I didn't really have an answer, but I didn't want to say I don't know.
And you didn't want to say I can't.
I didn't want to say I can't. So I said, you know what, let me find out. That's when I went online and I started learning about ebooks, Amazon, all the different providers of ebooks, and I discovered how difficult it is for African authors to put their books on Amazon. And I discovered that Amazon is not paying royalties to African banks. And I'm thinking to myself, really? Why? So I'm like, okay, I tell my author, I can put your book on Amazon, but you're gonna have to find a middleman. They're going to take out taxes, they're gonna take out all these things to get your money back. You might earn only like 1 cent when you're selling your book for $5, $6, $7. Is it worth it? So the author kept pushing me, like, we need to find something, we need to do something. So I put that man's book on Amazon. The next book comes out. What do they ask me? Ebook. Now, I'm looking at this man and how he's struggling. He's not making any money on Amazon. His book is there, but he's not seeing the fruit of it. And I didn't want the same thing to happen to the next. So what I did is I tell him, you know what? I'm working on a solution. Give me time. And every time after that, authors would ask me, ebook? And I'd tell them, I'm working on a solution. Give me time. I'm working on a solution. That was how African Books was born. And that was the heart behind it of, you know what? I don't like seeing this injustice. How come Amazon, how come Nook, how come Barnes & Noble, how come iBooks, how come all the providers of ebooks in the whole world not pay to African banks and not allow us to pay with mobile money or these things that make it simple for Africa to access it? So you say that Africa doesn't read, but you're not giving us the opportunities to access the content. And so my background of my childhood of not being allowed to say I can't gave birth to African Books, yeah, and to the innovation that now is the Amazon of Africa. So yeah, so I have my parents to thank. Those dollars I lost were worth it for africanbooks.com.
They did not pamper you?
They didn't pamper us at all. My dad we worked for my dad. I started working when I was 11. Because my dad owned a company. So, of course, we had our house chores and we had
office. For the house chores, you weren't paid for
I wasn't paid for house chores.
Oh, that was a duty.
Yes, as a duty for living there. My dad said that if you want to live in this house, you don't own this house, therefore you do chores. If you want an allowance for chores, you're going to pay me rent. I told him, Daddy, I will work for free. So I worked in the house. But then my dad also owned a company, and so he would allow us to log in hours and do secretarial work. So I used to log in and file paperwork for his company or do other jobs so I would earn from there. So I started earning in his company around age 11. I worked from him all through. He was so hard that when I hit 16 and I got my driving permit and I started driving, I wanted a car. My dad had several cars. I asked him for one. He told me no, but this one I want to sell. So if you want to buy it from me, the actual blue book value is $3,000. I will sell it to you for $3,000. And I used the money I had earned over all those years and bought that car from my dad.
The money he used to pay.
Returned back to him. And when I hit 18, I was going to university. I stopped working in his company. The guy at 18 started charging me rent to live in his house. And I paid rent until I moved out from age 18, from my room, my bedroom, from age 18 to 24 when I lived there, I paid rent. And the rent used to increase every year. By the time I hit 24, I was like, I can't afford dad's house anymore. I'm out. I went and rented a different room from a friend of
Your
mine.
Your mother couldn't come in to tell him, calm down, that's our daughter.
No. Did something to annoy him. He was, at times he would just increase the rent. So you're like, ah. I think when I moved out, the rent had increased to $700 a month. No, I swear.
$700?
Yes, yeah.
Paid to your father?
Paid to my father.
And your mom was watching everything?
Of course, but you know what? They have taught me and my brothers to be hard workers. Like, actually, I can't fail. I bought a house early after that. It provoked me to also now earn a living, make money, you know, be a landlord. So to this day, I have my house in California and I'm a landlord, you know, yet I'm in Uganda. So, yeah, those are my parents. Now, when I was a kid, I used to get annoyed, like, man, why is life hard? Like, really? My parents are hard. But looking back and as an adult, I think I'd do the same thing to my kids. Yeah, because what I have gained now, I'm years and decades ahead of my peers. Yeah, I'm years and decades ahead. So we need to stop pampering our kids and thinking that, you know, we're making life easy for them. You're only handicapping them in the future. So, yeah, it's... The Bible talks about spoiling the child, eh? The rod and spoiling child. Yeah, I had my share of rods. I had my share of rent and hard work. But I can tell you, I can do anything now. I can build your house. I can roof it. I can tile it. I can, you know, anything you ask me to do, I can do it. And if I don't know how to do it, I know where to access the information to learn.
So, oh my.
Yeah, okay. That is all thanks to my parents and my background. Yes.
Lena, there's something I think we've missed. Here's Lena Pira,
yes.
Gorgeous as you are.
Yes.
Is there anyone, you know, who's popped a question or something? Are you seeing?
Many people have popped questions,
and?
But many people have not been God's heart for me. Yeah, because I'm looking for someone who understands my heart of missions, and most people have not understood my faith to the degree that I need a husband, because as a wife I'm going to help my husband, but he also has a lot to do with my destiny, and I want to make sure that that man understands my heart for missions and the gospel before I say I do. Yeah, but I know he's very close by. See, so don't worry, you'll get an invitation. You'll get an invitation.
Usually, that's the debate. Yes. To find a man after God's own heart, yes, that will guide you in this relationship called marriage, or you get married and along the way he learns about God from you.
Understand, yeah.
But you're not going that way.
No.
Okay.
Yeah, my marriage is definitely going to be about purpose.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's purpose-filled, and I think marriage should be purpose-filled.
Okay.
And we have a lot to do together, so I'm looking forward to that man coming. There's some things I know.
Okay.
That we have a lot to do together.
Amen. Is there anything you'd like to share?
No, I would just love to say thank you. This has been a beautiful time. I think we could talk for hours and years.
No, we're going to talk after the show.
Yes, yeah. So I'm available whenever you need me. Just knock on my door and I'm here too. Yeah.
Thank you, Lena.
Yes, yeah, thank you too.
Good night, viewers. This has been Lena Pira. Till next time, goodbye.